Simon & Schuster Australia presents Daughter of Calabria, written by Tania Blanchard, narrated by Arianwen Parkes-Lockwood. For the amazing women of my family, their strength, tenacity, and perseverance are a continual source of inspiration. Love is the crowning grace of humanity, the holiest rite of the soul, the golden link which binds us to duty and truth, the redeeming principle that chiefly reconciles the heart to life and is prophetic of eternal good. Francesco Petrarch. Chapter 1. February 1936. Calabria, southern Italy. I followed the nun in a haze of exhaustion. I had been trying to memorize the turns along the corridors of the monastery, but when we finally stopped, I realized that I was utterly lost.
"Here we are," said the nun, opening the door to my cell. "You'll find it has everything you need."
She smiled encouragingly.
"It will feel like home before you know it."
"Grazie, sorella," I said in a small voice.
"One of the sisters will take you to see Mother Superior in the morning."
"Buonanotte," she said, before turning back down the long corridor.
I raised my lantern and surveyed the tiny room. A wave of loneliness overcame me and I burst into tears. I'd never been away from home before, and I already missed my family. The single bed against the whitewashed wall was covered with a sheepskin spread, with another sheepskin on the stone floor under the narrow window. The plain cell was more than I was used to. I'd never had the luxury of privacy and freedom of my own space before. But it wasn't home. How would I ever sleep without the comfort of my sister Paola's warm body next to me, and the soft, sleepy noises of my oldest sister Teresa in the bed beside us? I sat heavily on the bed. I was so far from everyone I loved, and it was my own fault. My family would be celebrating the last night before Teresa's wedding, enjoying a specially cooked meal. I could picture them laughing, singing and dancing to the music of fiddles and accordions as our neighbours and friends joined in. The view of the village from our hillside farm, about a 15-minute walk from our home, flashed through my mind. The tumble of red terracotta roofs and white lime-washed walls on the river flats. Bruzzano was a small village situated on the very tip of the toe of Italy, just a stone's throw from the island of Sicily. The Bruzzano River ran right alongside the town, moving slowly towards the east coast, while the Aspromonte Mountains towered around it, stretching to the very edges of Calabria's coastline like guardians. A wave of fresh tears turned into gasping sobs as I collapsed into the comfort of the sheepskin. 2 days earlier, Papa had summoned me to the dining table, his face like thunder. At 42, he was fit and strong from all the work on the land and, despite the long hours and constant worry over whether we'd have enough food to keep us going for another year, he didn't look his age. His hair was still thick, with only a few strands of grey that glinted against the black curls. He often told us that his grey hairs had sprouted because he had to provide for 5 children. And when I looked at Mama, who did the most for us, 3 years younger than Papa, but her hair streaked with grey, I thought maybe he was right. Vincenzo was the oldest of us at 21, then Teresa a year younger. Paola, 18, was nearly 2 years older than me, and then there was Antonio, who was 14. But I was the one who gave him the most grief.
"Did you look after the sheep yesterday for Vincenzo?" he asked as he finished off his caffè e latte.
"No, Papa," I whispered, standing before him in bare feet on the tiles.
But I had covered for Vincenzo, who was supposed to look after the sheep on our 30-acre farm. As shepherd, it was his job to keep them safe from wild animals, especially wolves. But he'd wanted to visit a girl, his latest amore, in the village, before he left for Africa with the army. He had taken his best friends, Stefano and Angelo Modafferi, cousins who lived in the next village, with him, to act as lookout. Although the cousins were just like brothers to us, spending as much time at our home while we were growing up as Vincenzo did at theirs, sometimes I wasn't sure I liked them, despite their jokes and clowning around. They could be dismissive, arrogant and annoying, pulling our hair, taking our biscotti, and refusing to let us play football because we were girls. But I didn't mind helping Vincenzo because, when I did, I felt like I was a part of a world that was carefree and wild. I longed for the freedoms the boys had. Papa stared at me, his dark eyes, usually filled with kindness for his daughters, hard as obsidian.
"Don't lie to me, Julia."
"I'm not." I knew how much trouble Vincenzo would be in if Papa found out he was sneaking away rather than doing his work. Papa had caught me telling lies more than a few times, but there was no way he could know the truth this time. I'd been so careful, and even though one of the boys from the adjoining farm had come across to play cards and offered me my first cigarette, I'd only taken one puff before giving it back.
"Mamma mia!" He slammed the table. "Then who did? Because he was seen in the village when he was supposed to be with the sheep. If anything had happened to even one of them."
I flinched and swallowed hard. "Whoever thinks they saw him must be mistaken," I lied. I was in too deep now to come clean.
"Testa dura,"
Papa rumbled, his hands pressed together as if asking for God's help.
"You told your mother you were going to help Zia Francesca at the trattoria, but I was talking to Signora Lipari at the post office this morning, and she said she saw you walking in the opposite direction, towards the farm, and worse still, that her nephew saw you in the field."
He shook his head.
"I don't know where to begin. It's bad enough that you were smoking cigarettes, but you were alone with a boy, and you're still lying to me. You know how much I hate lying. I'm so very disappointed in you."
My heart fell.
"But Papa..."
He put his hand up to stop me.
"Basta! Enough, Julia. You will go nowhere until I'm satisfied that you've learnt your lesson. For a girl your age, you should know better. I thought you'd learned after the incident with the bicycle."
I dropped my gaze. I'd taken the bicycle without asking, to borrow a white blouse I was supposed to wear as part of my uniform for the weekly fascist parade. I'd hidden my blouse, which had a large mud stain and a tear from chasing Antonio after the last parade. The only problem was that I'd got a flat tire on the way home. Mama found out about the blouse, and the tire cost a lot for Papa to have fixed.
"I've indulged you and tolerated your impetuous ways for far too long. You have to learn obedience and your place in this village, because this is where you belong."
I saw red.
"I'll never belong here," I shouted. "And why do I have to do what I'm told when the boys do whatever they want?"
"Because it's the way things are done. If you don't learn some respect and you keep on like this, nobody will want you."
"I don't care. Damn the way things are done. Why would I want to be stuck here in a dead-end village with people who can't see beyond their own noses?"
Papa got up so quickly, his chair crashed to the ground.
"I have a good mind to find you a husband who'll tame your wild ways and teach you respect. I'd rather die than marry anyone you want me to."
We were nose to nose.
"Go to your room," bellowed Papa, "and don't come out until you're ready to see sense." "Well, that would be never,"
I screamed, turning on my heel and rushing to my bedroom, slamming the door behind me. The memory of that fight still made my blood boil. Sobbing, I buried my face in the sheepskin and pounded my pillow with fury until I was spent. I took a shuddering breath and stared at the shadows the lantern made on the ceiling wall. I was here now and had to make the best of it. Somehow, the Madonna had heard my prayers and given me an opportunity to do what I'd always dreamed of. I'd finished school nearly 2 years earlier, at the age of 14. At first, I helped Papa on the farm with Paola. As well as tending our flock of sheep, we planted wheat and had an olive grove, a small orchard of citrus trees, and some grapevines for wine. We raised pigs, chickens, and goats, and had our milking cow Bella and our donkey Benito, named after Il Duce, Prime Minister Mussolini.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.